بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه. الحمد لله كما يحب ربنا ويرضى. الحمد لله على آلائه والشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه. والصلاة والسلام على خير الخلق نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله ومن تبعه بإحسان إلى يوم البعث والنشور. أيها الإخوة المؤمنون, dear respected brothers and sisters, in this episode we will be starting to talk about a very distinguished personality, a personality that is considered to be unique in terms of knowledge, in terms of its position in al-Islam, in terms of its akhlaq, in terms of its character, in terms of its wisdom. A very unique personality. In fact, many scholars consider this personality as the fifth rightly guided caliphs. We have four rightly guided caliphs: Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. And many scholars looked at this personality as the fifth rightly guided Khalifa, Umar ibn Abdul-Aziz. We are going to discuss the story of Umar ibn Abdul-Aziz. May Allah Jalla wa Ala be pleased with him. As we said, it is a unique personality, and this personality was rounded, and it was unique in terms of ibadah, unique in terms of akhlaq, unique in terms of wisdom, unique in terms of zuhd, unique in terms of the administration and the governance of the country at that time. He was a khalifa. And we will be looking at his personality from this perspective in order to what? To widen our scope when we discuss the stories of the second generation. We don't want to discuss, to limit our discussion to ibadat, acts of worship, how the second generation used to conduct themselves in terms of salah, siyam, giving sadaqah, or helping others. No, but we would like also to see how they used to govern how did they used to govern countries. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he followed Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik. Let me give you a brief history of the Umayyan period. As you know, that Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was killed in the year of 40 of Hijra. At that time, there was a fitna. The end of the fitna, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was established as the Khalifa. He continued as a Khalifa until year 60. After Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, his son Yazid ibn Muawiyah took over. Yazid ibn Muawiyah remained in charge of Muslims as a Khalifa from year 60 to year 64. After Yazid ibn Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, there was another khalifa for a very short period of time, 30 or 40 days, Muawiyah ibn Yazid ibn Muawiyah. This is considered to be the Sufyani lineage of the Umayyan people. Then after that, the Marwani lineage or the Marwani branch took over. What is the Sufyani branch and what is the Marwani branch? The Sufyani branch, as you know, brothers and sisters, that Abdu Manaf is the grandfather of Quraysh. He had two children, Hashim and Abdu Shams. Hashim is the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And Abdu Manaf had two sons, Rabi'a and Umayya. Umayya, he is the grandfather of Umayyan tribe. He is the grandfather of Umayyin. Umayya had two children, Harb and Abu al-As. Harb is the grandfather of Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Harb, his son is Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is known as Abu Sufyan ibn Harb. The son of Abu Sufyan is Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, which we just mentioned. However, the brother of Harb, he is Abul-Aas, he was Abul-Aas. Harb and Abul-Aas, we said that they are the children of Umayyah, the grandfather of the Umayyan tribe or the Umayyan people. Abul-Aas had two children, Affan, the father of Uthman radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and he has the other son, Al-Hakam. Al-Hakam, he had this son whose name is Marwan. So Marwan, of course, accepted Islam, and he was one of the Tabi'een, one of the companions of the Sahaba. So his name is Marwan, Ibn al-Hakam, Ibn Abil-Aas, Ibn Umayyah. Marwan, Ibn al-Hakam, Ibn Abil-Aas, Ibn Umayyah. So this is called the Marwani branch. And the other branch, the branch of Muawiyah, Ibn Abi Sufyan, Ibn Harb, Ibn Umayyah, called the Sufyani branch. So the Sufyani branch remained for some years as the Khalifas. Muawiyah, followed by Yazid ibn Muawiyah, followed by Muawiyah ibn Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Then after that, there was, of course, at that time, the fitna of Abdullah ibn Zubayr, and he was in charge of Al-Hijaz, and then the Umayyan people were in charge of Al-Sham, and you know the stories that happened, and the fitna that took place, and the killing of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Anyway, after the after Muawiyah ibn Yazid ibn Muawiyah died, the Khilafah moved to who? Moved to the Marwani branch. The first Khalifa of the Marwani branch was Marwan ibn al-Hakam. Marwan ibn al-Hakam, he was one of the Tabi'een, and he was a scholar, as many scholars said. Marwan ibn al-Hakam, his son is Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. Marwan ibn al-Hakam took over from year 64. He was the Khalifa from year 64 until 65, for almost 1 year. Then from year 65 all the way to year 86, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan was the Khalifa. He has the longest period, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan had number of children. Two of them became the Khalifa before Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, and two of them became the Khalifas after Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. So Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, his first son, Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, became the Khalifa after him. We said that Abdul Malik ibn Marwan continued as a Khalifa for almost 20 years. His son, Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik, continued as a Khalifa for almost 10 years until year 96. Then his brother, Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam, continued as a Khalifa for almost 3 years or 2 years and something. Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, he continued as a Khalifa from 96 until 99. After Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz came. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, his name is Umar ibn Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam. So he was their cousin. He was not from the children of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. So he was the cousins. He became a Khalifa in between the brothers of who? Of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. Marwan ibn al-Hakam had two children, Abdul Malik and Abdul Aziz. Abdul Aziz has his son, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, is the personality that we are talking about this episode. And maybe we will be, inshallah, talking about his biography, because it is a very rich story, a very rich biography. We'll be maybe talking about it for maybe 6-7 episodes. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and may Allah jalla wa ala be pleased with him, continued in Khilafah for 2 years only, 2 years plus a few months from year 99 until year 101. What is the story of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz? This is the lineage of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz from his father's side. Now let us talk about the lineage of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz from his mother's side, because such personality, we need to know a little bit about its history. You know, during the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, himself Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he was a khalifa, he was doing policing. So at night, he would go and walk in the streets of Al-Madinah as a police person, just to see what is happening and to monitor the situation. Who was doing this? Umar, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, himself. He was not just sending people to do this. He wants to see what is happening. So that's why some of his companions, they said when they noticed what he was doing, they said, no khalifa can compete with you. In fact, all of them will be tired because of what you have done, ya Umar ibn al-Khattab. At one night, Umar ibn al-Khattab was doing this patrol policing. He heard a conversation between a mother and her daughter. The mother said to her daughter, oh my daughter, you need to mix the milk with water. Mixing the milk with water increases the amount of milk and of course reduces the quality of milk. And this is cheating. Obviously, this is cheating. So the daughter told her mom, but this is not allowed. Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, said, don't do it. The mother told her, Umar ibn al-Khattab is not with us. He doesn't see us now, so do it. The daughter told her mom, if Umar ibn al-Khattab doesn't see us, the Lord of Umar ibn al-Khattab sees us. Allah sees us. Umar ibn al-Khattab was listening to this conversation and he was so amazed. This is a very important lesson, brothers and sisters. Sometimes you might break certain Sharia guidelines. And those Sharia guidelines, you think that you are free to break them because the people in charge or other people are not watching you. They don't know about you, so you can commit some sins secretly. But in fact, I have to stop here because they are telling me that it is the time for a break. Let us have a break. We will continue the story after the break. Stay with us. Assalamu alaikum.
Go ahead and recite from the beginning, because I have a few comments on the previous recitation. It was great, but I would like to share with each other some comments on a few letters. So I would request you to recite from the beginning, Ya Shu'aib, please.
Okay,
Do not be afraid to say Yasha. Do not say Yasha. This is wrong. There is no such recitation.
مثل الذين حملوا التوراة ثم لم يحملوها كمثل الحمار يحمل أسفارا بئس مثل القوم الذين كذبوا بآيات الله والله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back, brothers and sisters. We were discussing the story of Umar ibn al-Khattab and the lady. So, we were saying that the lady told her daughter to mix milk, to cheat. And the daughter responded by saying, this is not allowed. The mother told her that, oh, Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Khalifa at that time, doesn't see us. So the daughter responded by saying, if Umar, the leader, does not see us, Allah sees us. And as I was saying that sometimes some people commit sins, think that they are doing these sins secretly. And they don't know that the most important thing, that Allah is monitoring them. This is clear. However, brothers and sisters, sometimes a person might commit sins and he might be even exposed. He might think that he is safe from the eyes of people, but he doesn't know how people might know about his sin and how Allah Jalla wa'ala might expose his sin. In fact, some scholars said that anyone who is committing a sin, definitely one time, anyone who is committing regular sins, definitely one time he will be exposed. If he is not exposed explicitly, the signs of the sin or the sins that he is committing will be visible on his face. And that's why Allah Jalla wa'ala praises those who do not commit sin secretly. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَيْبِ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ. Anyway, let us go back to the story. Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he heard this conversation, he was amazed. And then he went back, he asked about this house, who are there? Then they told him that this house belongs to a lady from Bani Hilal. A lady from Bani Hilal. So he gathered his children and he told his son, Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umar ibn al-Khattab had number of children. Among them is Abdullah ibn Umar, as you know, and Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. He told his son Asim, oh my son, marry this lady. This lady will be good for you. This young lady will be good for you. And I believe that Allah Jalla wa'ala will give her a children who will lead Arabs. So among the offspring of this lady will be children who will lead Arabs, which means among the offspring of you, your offspring will be a children, will be one who will lead Arabs. Al-Layth ibn Sa'd, one of the greatest scholars, he said that firasa is long sighting, is three incidents. Amazing firasa, long sighting, where you predict something. And Allah Jalla wa'ala gives this to certain people. He said the story of Al-Aziz, when he called Yusuf and appointed him as the treasurer. So this is the story, and the story is mentioned in Surah Yusuf. Then he said the firasa of Umar ibn al-Khattab, the long sighting, and what Umar ibn al-Khattab predicted that this will happen. And that's why he advised his son Asim to get married to this lady. And the third one is what? When Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, he predicted that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz will be a good leader for Muslims. So he gave Umar ibn Abdul Aziz the wilayat al-ahd. He appointed him as wali al-ahd, which means that he will be the Khalifa after Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik. And they said all these firasat, or all these predictions, happened as they were expected. This story continues. So Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab got married to this lady. This lady gave birth to a daughter and named her Umm Asim bint Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umm Asim bint Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab got married to Abdul-Azeez ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam. We just mentioned Abdul-Azeez ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam. So Abdul-Azeez ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam got married to who? To a lady whose grandfather was Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. The lady called Asim bint Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Which means that Abdul-Azeez ibn Marwan, he himself was who? Was the brother-in-law of Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So they were having musahara. They have been in-laws for each other and they married from each other. Abdul-Azeez ibn Marwan, Abdul-Azeez ibn Marwan, the wife of Asim bint Asim, his wife gave birth to who? To Umar. Gave birth to Umar. She named her son as her grandfather, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So she called him Umar as her father called Umar, or as her grandfather called Umar. So his name was Umar ibn Abdul-Azeez ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam. From his mother's side, he is Umar, the son of Asim, the daughter of Asim, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So from a lineage perspective, he was one of the most dignified people, the dignitarians of Bani Umayyah and Bani Umayyah from Quraysh. So this is the lineage of Umar ibn Abdul-Azeez, and this is the story of his grandfather and grandmother. Umar ibn Abdul-Azeez radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was born in Medina, and at that time his father Abdul-Azeez was a governor of Medina. So he spent some time in Medina. During that time in Medina, Abdullah ibn Umar, his khal, his uncle, maternal uncle, was living in Medina. So he spent some time with his maternal uncle, the Sahabi, the famous Sahabi, Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. And that period, in fact, had an impact in his personality. In fact, it has molded the personality of Umar ibn Abdul-Azeez radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And one time, he said to his mother that I would like to be like my khal. I would like to be like my uncle Abdullah ibn Umar. And she said, are you going to be like your uncle Abdullah ibn Umar? Oh, that is impossible, or that is ba'id. That is far away. Maybe she has said this in a way to encourage him to strive hard to be like his uncle Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. And they said that he has spent some time with Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. His father was the governor of al-Madinah. Then he was appointed to be the governor of Egypt. So he left to Egypt first to see the situation in Egypt. And after seeing the situation in Egypt, he would call for his wife, Asim, as well as his son, to come along to join him in Egypt. After some time, he sent a letter to his wife to join him. So his wife went to Abdullah ibn Umar, her uncle, to consult him. And she said to him, what do you think? Abdullah ibn Umar responded to her by saying that your son is very similar to Al-Umar ibn al-Khattab. He's very similar to us. So why don't you allow him to spend more time with us? So she liked this idea, and she went by herself to join her husband in Egypt. I think we are coming to the end of this episode. Inshallah, we will continue the story, the amazing story of Umar ibn Abdul-Azeez, inshallah, in the coming episode. Until then, I ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to protect you, to protect all of us. I ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to bestow His guidance upon us and to make us among the people who benefit from those stories. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.